if you know Felicia Shaw, you know that I'm not Felicia Shaw. Unfortunately, Felicia's not feeling well. So my name is Roseanne Weiss, and I work for Felicia at the Regional Arts Commission of St. Louis. My title there is Director of Artists and Community Initiatives. So I think we have some competition next door. So the thing that we're going to do today is a little tiny bit different than maybe what the description was. When we all got together, we decided that really what we wanted to talk about was what happens in art in times of crisis. And so memorials, history, and controversy, and really turning to art in a time of crisis. So with me today is Gwen Keithley, and Gwen is the Vice Provost for Research and Graduate Studies at Maryland Institute College of Art, and she oversees 16 graduate programs and facilities, the projects and publication activities of 3 research centers, Center for Design Practice, Center for Design Thinking, and Center for Race and Culture. So that means you're busy, right? Obehi Janis is an award-winning actress, writer, and comedian, and she is the TCG Fox Foundation resident actor at Company One Theater in Boston. And Obehi was named Boston's best actress by the Improper Bostonian in 2014. So is there, are there improper Bostonians in here? All right. Her recent acting credits include An Octoroon, We're Gonna Die, and Mr. G. So I'm looking forward to having this discussion with all of them. So what I'm going to do actually is channel my boss, Felicia Shaw. I know all of you have had that situation where you had to channel your boss. She's got a presentation and an introduction, and if you bear with me and let me read it, I apologize for reading, but I think it's the best I can do with the channeling, right? So I'll be moderating actually today this session, which will look at how in the time of civil unrest, we as artists and arts administrators navigate that terrain when we have so many conflicting interests, from public sentiments to internal bureaucracies to our own personal perspectives on what is right and what is wrong. I want you to first imagine an America trying to navigate our historic quest without artists, agitating our journey along the way. Imagine the civil rights movement without freedom songs like We Shall Overcome, or the politics of women's movements without the literary contributions of women such as Maya Angelou, Eve Ensler, and Virginia Woolf. From the street drama of the Black Panthers to the revolutionary murals of the Chicano movement, to the guerrilla tactics of women's rights activists, artists have been and will continue to be at the center of social change efforts around the world and are using every platform available to them, from the traditional to the latest in technology, to give their work a stage. Who could forget Beyoncé and her girls in formation at the Super Bowl? Her statement on Black identity and send-up of the Black Power movement. It was seen around the world by millions. When Michael Brown was gunned down by a white police officer in Ferguson, Missouri, St. Louis artists mobilized and were on the ground working to quell the unrest and provide a different response to the unrest than what you see in the media. 2 years later, artists across the country continue to respond to racial and economic inequities with a renewed sense of grassroots activism. And I'm going to speak a little later about that as well from the St. Louis perspective. This afternoon, we will hear the stories of 3 communities, St. Louis, Baltimore, and Boston, and how artists there responded to social challenges that agitated their neighborhoods. We'll hear from an individual artist who worked outside of the structure of an institution, that's Obehi, and used storytelling abilities to connect with people's pain. Next, we'll hear from a local arts agency that witnessed protesters outside their door while trying to figure out how to turn around a grant process in a matter of days so that artists could continue to be responsive to the uprising that was in progress, and that's what you'll hear about from me. And finally, we will hear from a representative of a college that was so intentional about its commitment to civil engagement that it created a position, and that's what you'll hear from Gwen. In our brief session today, we'll try and connect the dots after our presentations and through a discussion of how we as cultural leaders navigate this space with all of its complexities. From how to support artistic work in the midst of an uprising to how we lead when asked to weigh in on the future of controversial work that is already in the public realm, but there is a growing push for it to be removed. I just want to point out the image of the bears on the pole. That's from an artist in St. Louis named Lois Ingram, and I'll refer to that a little later as well. She calls them monuments, and they're, of course, to people who were killed in some kind of violent way on the street. So, Obey, I'm going to turn this over to you to talk a little bit about your experiences and what you've been doing.
Great. How's everybody? Good. All right. I had something really funny happen to me. Funny things happen to me every day. A colleague just ran up to me and said, "Why are you in this session? Memorials?" And I think she was essentially asking me, what do I have to say? And I'm always interested in that. Sort of what am I allowed to say and when and where? Because again, on paper, on my business card, in public, I'm, you know, very much like I'm a working actor, writer, comedian, I produce, I direct. I work in the system of the performing arts, and I desire to have a long life in the performing arts, as difficult as it may be. But what has naturally happened, and I think Felicia's images show that, is we're in a time where artists, as Nina Simone would say, have to reflect the times. I don't really know any working artist that is not feeling convicted by what is happening for our generations, who be them young or old or whatever we may be, we're just doing a lot of questioning. So even as I go through the trials and tribulations of auditioning and creating, I do carve out a lot of space for a lot of self-reflection and for gathering and for just sort of like hacking and trying to activate space. So winter 2014, when we lost some people, in memory of some people, including Michael Brown and Eric Garner, what happened in Boston was, for a city that's very Puritan, so you're here right now, and I'm not really unabashed what I'm about to say, because I mean, like, again, I represent myself, really. You know, this city was really challenged by a bevy of like awesome activist spirit that kind of hit downtown. I remember specifically our annual Christmas tree lighting ceremony got hacked and disrupted. With Black Lives Matter protesters and others. City Hall was bombarded, the State House was bombarded. You know, we have a really small city in Boston, but it's not difficult to just feel the way in which like written history, hidden history kind of just like bubble to the surface. And we also are a very segregated city. So there are ways in which, though Mike Brown, we lost him, and he seemed far away, it immediately felt really close. So a couple things happened. A lot of awesome marches and walks and die-ins happened. And then what happened where, for a city, again, that does not, individual artists leave constantly, and artists don't always feel like they should be creating, suddenly artists were creating. So I had colleagues like friends from Intelligent Mischief who started raising money for this thing called the Black Body Survival Guide, where it is like a multi-medium book that essentially says like, Black people, here's what you can do to survive a shooting. Or we had artists like projecting hands up like on buildings, and I could go on. So I decided that I was going to create a space and a public space for people to just say what they needed to say. And usually when I'm creating, the title comes to me first, and the title that came to me was Creative Witness. Because I do think that a lot of empathy is needed right now, and witness can be an actual court witness, but I think when we think of the word witness, we think of just like being present to be supportive and to bring validity to what people are feeling. So anyways, I grab a friend and I say, hey, like, why don't we put up a Facebook group and let's just like see who comes out to Boston Common. So Boston Common is like the center of Boston. The Improper Bostonian is actually a riff on the book called The Proper Bostonian. So again, with Boston history, is Boston is obsessed with like what is actually proper Boston. So when a tree lighting gets disrupted, or when Newbury Street is bombarded with activists, people get really nervous. People get really upset, meaning like the police and like the mayor and et cetera. So I decided, well, the least that we can do is like do it at night. So I was being nice, but I was just like, we'll do it at night. Like nobody's gonna come, like whatever, it's gonna be whatever. So we put up the Facebook group, people are coming up. The day of, what I remember distinctly was like, we totally illegally brought in a, what do you call it? A generator? Mm-hmm. Brought in a generator to power the microphone. And I remember I was just like, oh, if this blows up, we're gonna get in trouble. Like that was my least of my worries. Like, oh, we're like using a generator. This is really crazy. So to me, like all we're doing is curating a space for like, you know, some poetry, some songs, whatever. And then like the minute we start, like I see like three police cars to my left, like just waiting. I was super confused. I remember being like, don't they know that like I am the least of their worries? Like, what is it? But I remember feeling, because we were activating a space without a permit, that's what I remember, is we didn't get a permit. So then I said, well, screw the permit. I don't really care about the permit. And we were out there and we were around the fountain where a lot of homeless people are. Like, I just remember being like, we're in the center of the city. This is supposed to be a nice space and we're just gonna do something. And then the police were there. And the event was really powerful. Some people brought art. Some people sang songs and did poetry. We chalked the whole common around the fountain. And then eventually the police went away. So that to me was, I'm still processing what that meant. So I hope that this makes sense, that like I'm an artist. So as somebody who created the space, I don't really have something super concrete to say, like this is what happened with our hearts. But I do remember people saying, we need more of this in Boston. Why isn't this happening? Why don't we just do this? And I realized like we put up this sort of fear wall, or like we let the sort of puritanical nature of our city kind of seep into even our impulses as artists and just as creative people. So that was, I'd say, the first time in my creative life here in the city where I said, I don't really care what I need to do government-wise, and I'm just going to do this. And I feel like that definitely colored winter 2014. And looking forward, that's what I'm interested in, is sort of what I've been calling like hacking spaces. So as I look towards discussing gun violence, welcoming safe spaces for people of color, queer people, that's what I'm interested in, is sort of just why should we wait to get a permit from a building? So that's where I'm at, is thinking about that. Yeah. And I think too, I'm interested in why you decided to sit here today, too. So that's what I.
All right. We'll go through this. We'll have a chance to talk this through. Okay, let's see if I can do this. All right, I may need help.
Do you need to close this window
yeah.
open yours? Okay.
That one.
I think we did that.
All right, sorry.
No. Do you want me to do that?
There we go. All right, how do we do that then to the next one?
Maybe just do this. I can't get this to, I can't find it. It's over on the screen. There it goes.
This is a Mac person trying to do a PC. It's like a commercial.
We're both fumbling.
Yeah, there we go. We got help coming. All right. Here we go. That's the one I want, right? And then I need that to come up. Great. Thank you.
Sorry for technical difficulties. So, Regional Arts Commission of St. Louis, we are a local arts agency, right? As many of you I know come from local arts agencies at this conference. We've been around for 30 years. We are St. Louis City and County. I don't know if you're familiar with St. Louis City and County, but that represents 92 municipalities. Some of those municipalities, cities, towns, have 600 people who live in them. Some of them have 500,000 people who live in them. And all of that is an important thing to know, because those little towns and cities represent about 60 different police departments, which leads to August 9th, 2014. So I want to take you back there. It is a very important time for us. It is a time when we sort of say before and after. It is that kind of mark for us. At the Regional Arts Commission and in my job for the almost 20 years, for 19 years now, we have been having the Community Arts Training Institute. You will hear us talk about the Cat Institute, and it has nothing to do with cats, although we call each other cats. So the Community Arts Training Institute is a cross-sector training. Artists of all disciplines and community activists of all kinds, cross-trained for 5 months. And we've been doing this for about 19 years. So there are now about 300 Cat Institute alums working and often working together, which is part of the point of people working within communities and understanding each other's language. So the kinds of things that we discuss in the Cat Institute are just that: how to collaborate, how to enter and exit communities, how to be with communities and not be doing something for them, and what the difference is. What the difference is between social practice and community arts. What the difference is between being an individual artist and working within communities and understanding collective art making and creativity problem and problem solving. So there's this group of people who every year we train. So 16 people, again, 8 artists of all disciplines, 8 people who are activists of some way, shape, or form. They could be policymakers, they could be social workers, they could be teachers, but in some way, shape, or form, non-artists working with artists. Mm. So that sets up sort of who we are and what's going on. This is the latest class. We now do two of these trainings a year. One we call the Regional Community Arts Training Institute, where we're taking people from all around the region. And then another that we call neighborhood or place-based, where we dive deep into a neighborhood where we feel invited in. So there's a really vast network. This was a sort of data collecting manifestation where we asked all of the Cat alums to string who they work with, right? So everybody's name was on a big board, and you took a string and you strung your name to somebody else that you have collaborated with or work with within the community. So it's a really wonderful sort of web of people who are connected to one another in all kinds of ways. So when Mike Brown was killed, it was a devastating moment in a way that is hard to almost talk about. It was an emotional time for all of us in so many ways. The blatant disrespect for the community and for him was devastating to all of us. The aftermath of the Ferguson Police Department, by the way, Ferguson is 20 minutes from my desk. So when I say Ferguson, I mean St. Louis. When I say St. Louis, I mean Ferguson. It was a very emotional time, and it's almost really hard to describe if you've not been in that situation. I happened to be out of town when Mike Brown was killed, and I'm coming back. I'm in the airport And I used to run a program for teenagers, who some of whom are still in contact with me. They're adults now. And I got a text from one of my friends still. His name is Ty. And Ty is a 20-something-year-old man now who is a graphic designer and web designer. And on the text, he said, "Roseanne, I just want you to know how much I've been thinking about you the last few days because of you. And because of art, I'm alive." So I knew what he meant. I asked him later, and he told me he was very much in a situation like Mike Brown, but that he knew that A, I would be disappointed in him, and B, he couldn't come to art class if something happened to him. So, you know, when people tell you the arts aren't important, I can just point to Ty. So those kinds of things, you know, were very emotional. It was in some ways a very dividing moment, but also some ways a moment when people really came together. So I use that as the background for talking about, you know, this what you're seeing right there is a memorial. It's a monument. It's a monument that came up within a street, people kept trying to take it away, and people kept putting it back up. So the Regional Arts Commission, I mean, we're a bureaucracy. We're an arts agency. But we did have this group of people, these 300 trained, interested, engaged people. So what do? We actually have a building. We have an office building with a gallery in the first floor and some meeting spaces and some conference rooms. So one of the things we did right away was become a meeting ground. We asked one of our CAT alums, who is a wonderful facilitator, to facilitate a group of meetings. And as you can imagine, they were very contentious. People were demanding things from us, which was fine. It was okay. We had three meetings. By the third meeting, people were much more specific on what they wanted and what they needed. And we could be much more specific about what we were able to do for the artists in town who wanted to work in this space and in this space and time. If you recall from the news, there were lots and lots of protests when the police came out with guns and tanks and sniper guns and unbelievable amounts of military armor. You know, there had to be a response to that, and the artists were ready. One of the things that I will say is that having the Community Arts Training Institute and having those 300 alums was amazingly important at that moment in a way that we could never have anticipated. One of the artists, Damon Davis, who actually Bob Lynch showed his work today at lunchtime, Damon went through the CAT Institute, and when I saw Damon and a group of other alums who were in a cafe meeting, you know, and I said, "Okay, what are you guys up to?" And they said, "Well, of course, we're plotting." And Damon had been at the end of 5 months on graduation day, said, "Roseanne, I'm still not sure why I did this." I said, "Okay, Damon, there's gonna be a moment when you see me and you're gonna say, 'Okay, I get it now.'" I said, "I promise, it's always what happens." So that day, Damon looked at me and he said, "Roseanne, I now get it. I get it. I get the whole thing about the Community Arts Training Institute. I get it. You gave us tools. And when I looked around at the front lines, at who I knew, who was getting tear gassed, the people I knew were all CAT alums." He said, "So that's it, isn't it? It's the network." And I said, "Yeah, it's the network." So one of the other things that the Regional Arts Commission did was that we hosted part of a citywide exhibition that was put together by a curator in town, Frieda Wheaton, in 14 different locations. And it was very important to have that work in our space as well. It was called Hands Up, Don't Shoot. A number of artists who were also CAT alums were in that show. Oops, I'm going back. And it was amazing because this work was all made very quickly, but very emotionally. And it was important to show it. Some of these artists were so inspired and so inspiring. One of the most interesting days when the show was up was the policeman who walked the beat in our neighborhood. We are, by the way, on Delmar, which is considered the divide. People call it the Delmar divide. So there's the north side and the south side, we are on that divide. And the policeman walking that beat came in, and they were very interested in the show, and we had some very interesting conversations about this show. They were trying very hard to be neutral, and I know that they were also incredibly emotional about it. So, you know, lots of projects, lots of things going on as more tragedies are happening across the country. The Catalums were making contact with people around the country. I'm missing one, but okay. Actually, the next slide, and I'm sorry it's missing, is one of Damon Davis's hands. Bob showed the hands that he created this whole series of photographs of the protesters' hands up, don't shoot, in black and white, and blew them up and pasted them all over the city. It was quite dramatic and quite wonderful. So one of the things that an arts agency like the Regional Arts Commission can do is that we actually have resources. So we can bring resources to the table. We created the Social Impact Fund almost very nimbly. We went into our reserves because we thought it was that important to meet the needs of the artists who felt like they needed to do some things right now on the ground that were arts-based. We created some workshops, and our artist support grants, which were already in place, we accelerated those a little bit, and we gave a lot of credence to the ones that were very interested in doing some social impact kinds of projects. So those were our resources. The other thing that happened was forward through Ferguson, a path towards racial equity, there was the Ferguson Commission, which was actually a very powerful commission. Often commissions are sort of lame, right? People get together, they talk, they think that's enough. The Ferguson Commission was led by Reverend Starsky Wilson, who is a very powerful person. And they came up with a report, like all commissions do, but they are very committed to not having that report sit on a shelf. So it is available digitally, and we are still working with them on their signature priorities and using the arts for those signature priorities. You know, it's 2 years later, and it's not gone away. One of the things that people say to me is, aren't you sick of this yet? Isn't it over? And it's not, and it won't be over until St. Louis is a much more racially equitable place. So some of the things that happened too were the Catalums wanted to show the work that they were doing. This is the mirror casket that was carried through the streets in a number of protests that was created by Dee Nichols and a number of other artists. The Smithsonian has acquired it for the new museum. Which we're very proud of. Chalk Unarmed, I'm sure that there were people everywhere who were doing this, and Chalk Unarmed was everywhere. You could see these kinds of things on the ground all throughout the city. One of the things that the artists did was they were meeting for workshops, they were doing drama on the streets. These things are still going on. It's not over. Food Spark, all kinds of things like this are going on. And I have to say that I feel very privileged to be part of the Community Arts Training Institute and to be connected to the folks that are involved in it. When we were in the midst of the protests, I felt like, gosh, I'm not doing enough. What more should I be doing? What else should be happening? You know, I can write the checks to get people out of jail. We can you know, make grants. We can have meeting space. We can provide support in whatever way, shape, or form. So what else should I be doing? And one of my cats turned to me and he said, Roseanne, don't you understand? I said, understand what? He said, you already did it. You trained us for this work. That's why we're on the ground, and that's why we're there. And in fact, it is why we're safe, because we know how to do this work, and we didn't have to find community partners. We are the partners. So that's one of the things that I think is really important to understand when we're doing community work, that it's not short-term, that it's long-term, and that partnerships are lifetime partnerships. And when you have crises, knowing people without having to find people is really what's the most important thing. So thank you. Another Mac person. There we go.
Got it. So is there anyone here from Baltimore? One here from Baltimore. Great. I thought there would likely be others from Baltimore here.
And we're fine.
Okay, good. Thank you. So before I begin, I wanted to thank Clay Lord for inviting me and probably all of us to participate on this panel. And it's been a real delight to work with Felicia, who I'm sorry isn't here, I haven't gotten to meet, who has done a wonderful job, I think, of helping to frame our work. And then to be talking to Roseanne and to Obehi on the phone and now to meet them in person. It's a real honor to be here and to be kind of sharing our stories with you. I think we are sharing, from the perspectives of artists and arts administrators, what we've done, how our institutions have responded to both social and civil unrest. And I even had in my text, like, when we've had to do that, because these things have presented themselves, at least in Baltimore and St. Louis. So my intention is to provide some information. Is anyone familiar with MICA, the Maryland Institute College of Art? Yay, so glad y'all heard about it. And our relationship to the city, the ways we've responded and continue to respond to the civil unrest. And I think as a group, we spoke a little bit about what we might present as lessons learned, or what I've called here, I think, propositions for how we think about arts and artist practices in the city moving forward with these conditions. I'm just going to give a quick background to the events that happened. I'm sorry, I'm sure most of you may know these, but I just want to make sure we're all on the same page. So Freddie Gray, it was a 25-year-old man who died from a spinal cord injury that he sustained while in police custody on April 19th, which was 2015. And he was taken into custody on April 12th, 2015. On Monday, April 27th, he was laid to rest, and on that night, there was a very angry Baltimore that took to the streets. Over 200 were arrested that night in demonstrations over the next few days. The Maryland National Guard was deployed, public schools were closed, and a citywide curfew was imposed for 6 days, which lasted until May 3rd. On Friday, May 1st, the state prosecutors announced that 6 officers involved in Gray's arrest would be charged for crimes, including homicide and manslaughter. The first of the 6 trials started last November. We're currently in the 3rd trial. This is with Officer Caesar Goodson, who was the driver of the van. And he actually carries, I think, the most kind of heavily weighted charges. But some consider the day of the riots and the media depiction of Baltimore burning to be, in fact, the uprising. Some include the time of the National Guard and when we were on curfew as being the uprising. But others really feel that the uprising is still ongoing. And I appreciate that Roseanne has a very kind of similar message. So although peaceful, the protests do continue. Marchers and protests protesters call not only for justice for Freddie Gray, but also for a more sustained look at the underlying problems that got us here. As MICA's president recently said, the civic unrest related to Freddie Gray's death has awakened the consciousness in the city and encouraged people not to be passive and not to let the inequity in the history, in the city's history and in our reality stand. There is a hopeful public will in the city to support its strengths, but also to work together and persuasively to lift inequity and remedy the situation. So although I will discuss our responses, and I'm talking collectively about the responses of MICA, of our faculty, our students, and our alumni, our response at MICA is actually also still ongoing. We continue to plan not only for keeping our community safe with the increase in crime in our neighborhood since the unrest, but also we continue to be involved. We continue to look for educational opportunities for our students to learn from these events and this history. And lastly, we continue to consider the new models for how to be involved and how to contribute and make a difference in our city. So I thought I'd give a little background to MICA. The Maryland Institute College of Art is an independent college of art and design, and we offer a unique environment focused solely on the education of artists and designers. We support approximately 2,200 students with 15 undergraduate majors and 20 graduate and post-baccalaureate programs. It's a very student-centered institution, and we're kind of relatively nimble in our ability to respond to student needs. Many of our programs have community engagement at their core. They integrate particular methodologies for working with others as central to their practices. In this way, MICA has a broader portfolio than a traditional art school because we have thought of art and design education within larger social and economic frameworks, not just the cultural arena. So we have five graduate programs that really focus on different kind of engagement with community, and those are listed here at the top: art education, community arts, curatorial practice, social design, et cetera. We have an Office of Community Engagement who really supports kind of more service learning activities across the institution, a special concentration in social practice, and awards that really recognize student work that catalyzes change in Baltimore neighborhoods. So I also wanted to say a little bit about Baltimore. Baltimore is a city that really provides very strong support for the artist community. This is a quote from our mayor who recently said that Baltimore does not have a monolithic or snobby arts culture, but instead Baltimore really has an organic, grassroots, and accessible arts culture. And here that this is kind of one of the charms of our culture is that it's always kind of hitting the refresh button. It's a very kind of DIY. And I particularly like these aspects of Baltimore because I'm running the graduate programs. It's a place that's really welcoming to emerging artists and our kind of students and faculty. It's very easy for them to get involved and be supported by this community. I just wanted to quickly point out that we have like three arts and entertainment districts in the city. And I don't have like the full complement of everything that's in Baltimore supporting the arts. So I wanted to point out just quickly, this is North Avenue, this orange line. I'm working on my map. North Avenue is somewhat of a kind of center of the city. I need to make my map, I need to work on it to kind of really project that idea a little bit more than it does, but it is a kind of, North Avenue is the site, and these dots are kind of showing where MICA's campus is on the right, and where the kind of epicenter of the riots was on the left, was just about a kind of mile to 2 miles down North Avenue. So although our geographical location on North Avenue, not only through our geographical location on North Avenue, we see our college as really part of the cultural fabric of the city. As a result, we respond to events in the city in a similar way to our community. We see the promise of Baltimore to grapple with the problems, while daunting and challenging and somewhat overwhelming, we really want to be part of the process of creating a new model for change. This shows the kind of orange line of our campus. So it's kind of right in the center of this activity. So given this context in the city, this does not mean that we are without our own challenges on campus. MICA is seen as a predominantly white college in a predominantly black city. As these questions about race and equity have been foregrounded in the national dialogue, our campus community has been reflecting and grappling with its own demographics, makeup, and power relationships. In October 2014, which was a graduate student in our community arts program, catalyzed a conversation that brought the community together to talk about diversity on campus. It at this time was called the Power Equity Forum, and it was a real grassroots effort to advance the dialogue among our faculty, staff, and students about diversity and inclusion on campus. I really don't think it was a mistake that this group emerged at the same time there's a heightened awareness in our city about institutional racism and social inequity. Responding to the recommendations from this group and other community events, the president has formed a task force on diversity, inclusion, and equity and globalization. And this year, this was just a series of events that they hosted, but that dialogue has been continuing in a somewhat more formalized form this year. So I'm going back a little ways. This is a map of the riots of Baltimore. And I just wanted to point out that MICA was close, I guess. And in fact, on the day of the riots, which was April 27th, we did issue a shelter-in-place warning. In the evening when there was some looting of a local kind of hardware store and grocery store, which is actually in our neighborhood. And we continued to observe the curfew as the rest of the city. But after the violence passed, MICA, its students, staff, and faculty were really immediately and actively involved. So the next day, which was at Tuesday, April 28th, Nate Larson, who's a photographer, took his class to Penn and North, which was the epicenter of the riots, and started taking this portrait series. I've kind of taken from three or four portrait series that he has of various participants in the protests and in the events during this time. Allison Fisher was part of the Globe Press, which is a press that we have on campus, and she worked with interns to print about 75 posters for a citywide student protest, which happened on Wednesday, April 29th. As she says, we got to use our tools here at MICA to contribute to the uprising and the events in the city. For a larger citywide rally that just happened a few days later, Allison reprinted her same posters, and they printed over 200 posters that were then carried down to City Hall and distributed and passed out for people in the square. One of, I think, the favorite ones was, invest in schools, not jails. Milani Douglas is a graduate, now a graduate of our curatorial practice program, MFA, but as part of her thesis, she had established a series of events in a laundromat, which were called Love on the Line, Stories of a Baltimore Worth Living For. And it happened that one of her events, she was hosting on the night of one of the protests, and the protest literally kind of terminated at her laundromat. Her laundromat was right off North Avenue, and I think this protest was coming down North Avenue. And so it was this kind of wonderful kind of happenstance that her event hosted kind of folks who were just coming off a protest. And as she says, the event provided a place for people to come together and to hang out. She was intent on creating this series with the knowledge of some of the problems, such as violence in Baltimore, but she really wanted to shift the focus to healing instead of hurting. So there were a series of performers in the laundromat. She also had kind of workshops for kids, and I think they had kind of dancers, and it was just a real time to kind of build community within this local space. a graduating BFA student, made over 500 Black Lives Matter patches that were worn as part of the graduating class and participating faculty at our MICA 2015 commencement. So this commencement happened in May, right after the uprising in April. And as she said, because of the campus's proximity and economic influence in the city, the pomp and circumstance of the upcoming commencement ceremony felt unneeded, undeserved, and out of place. These patches were simply an act of solidarity to do nothing tangible for the city and the community, of Penn North. However, I think it was important to have a piece of visual matter shaping discourse at commencement in some way. While intended for the students on the morning of the graduation, the entire stage of faculty proudly were wearing their patches, including President Hoy. This is work of our alumni, which happened in the summer after the uprising. Nora Howell runs, or she's the program director at Jubilee Arts Center, which is located in Sandtown, Winchester, which was Freddie Gray's neighborhood. And what was originally planned as one mural became a kind of eightfold project. They ended up doing, I think, eight different murals. And I'm bringing it up because this piece is up for an award here at this conference. I'll show you in a second. But it was a partnership with BOPA, which is Baltimore Office Promotion of the Arts, Baltimore City Youth Works Program, and they hired over 80 young people from the zip code around in this neighborhood, 21217, to act as artist apprentices with artists to create these murals. This is called Art at Work, Sandtown, and it is up, I guess there's going to be an announcement tomorrow.
It might have been today. Go ahead.
The website says it's coming up tomorrow.
Okay.
But I just wanted to point out, Nora, I was checking back in with Nora to see what they were planning for this summer, and she said, and we're up for this award, which was really pretty fantastic. What's interesting about this project is that it literally almost overnight went from one mural to eight murals in order to address the kind of community in particular. So as an educational institution, we also felt a responsibility to provide students an educational framework to understand what's going on in the city and to provide knowledge and information and approaches for how they may engage and choose to be involved. I have a few examples of courses that developed over this past year. And they were really designed to provide students with the critical and analytical tools to support productive engagement and contemporary thinking related to social justice. Sometimes I think when we're faced with the kind of problems we're addressing in Baltimore or in these cities, there's a real question about what can we do. And at least being an educational institution, we feel like this is something that we can do, is to craft our courses in this way. Do I need to worry about time?
I think got a couple more.
Okay. So this is a kind of response and a kind of series of points that our MAT, which is Master of Teaching program, and they're preparing arts educators for the city schools in Baltimore. And we're particularly faced with how do we kind of really teach our students about race, privilege, and equity within this kind of segregated city in an elite arts institution? How do we teach our students to engage young learners about race, privilege, and inequity? How do we really prepare agents of change, and so on? So these were just a kind of framework that they used and really deliberately integrated into their curriculum that answered these questions. And it was a real change. I know they kind of developed it over the summer and instituted it in the fall to bring kind of these things to bear in their classroom. The North Avenue Knowledge Exchange is actually not a class that we were teaching, but this was something that we developed in the community. MICA partnered with Station North Arts and Entertainment District and Red Emma's bookstore to create a kind of model of grassroots education. Basically, it works on the principles that everyone has something to teach and everyone has something to learn. So we did a pilot day on February 6th, which ran a series of free workshops, and these were kind of addressing both what the community wanted to learn as well as what people were willing to teach. And it was everything from kind of bicycle repair to kind of yoga classes to a drawing marathon and so on. But it was, this project is something that we're going to be able to continue, and I think we really saw it as a way of using kind of education as a platform to bring kind of our communities together on North Avenue and to build a stronger neighborhood. This year, our graduating commencement speaker was Kayla Ingram, and she was a graduate from our social design program. And she mentioned, I just wanted to kind of share a quote with her because I think it's poignant. I don't think this would have happened at another time, where she said, "What a poignant time in the history to be in Baltimore and to be at MICA. We have stretched ourselves and are growing beyond being artists who create art for monetary compensation to artists who create with intention and are conscious of the world around them. Apart from generating economic value, the arts and culture create an economy of empathy. Your art, your craft, your voice has the potential to rock the worlds of very people who are often so overlooked. This is not only how artists impact black spaces, this is about how artists impact life spaces. As innovators, environment shapers, risk takers, artist designers, and creators, we have a responsibility to leverage power and our personal privilege to push us to true equity." So this was a statement she was delivering to all of her fellow graduates from MICA that year. I'm on my last example, I promise. So this is an exhibition planned by our chair of painting, and he's an undergraduate chair of our painting department. And this is, it's interesting that you shared that example of an exhibition, because this is the first exhibition that I know of so far, and those of you in Baltimore, please correct me if I'm wrong. Bringing together, it's featuring 15 different artists who have some connection with Baltimore and who are responding to the uprising or to kind of social issues in some way. It's scheduled for November, and I think what's nice about the exhibition is not only is it going to have a panel discussion featuring the artists themselves, but it also is really thinking about how it connects with the community. So there's also a community kind of programming, and they'll be inviting kind of civil rights activists like DeRay McKesson, who's also contributing to the catalog, to lead a conversation and kind of bring the community in to dialogue around these images. So I said I was gonna end with kind of propositions for the arts and their impact. What I've tried to show here are kind of examples of the way, at least MICA and our artists, and you know, our the artists that work on our institute, you know, work as faculty that graduate from our kind of institution, how they have worked and contributed to the city. What I wanted to kind of emphasize here were kind of what we learned from them, and what these kind of new models for how artists engage might show us or might kind of prompt. So how might we advance creative practices that create an economy of empathy and challenge the boundaries of what we think art is? How do we invite ideas, responses from diverse constituencies to create stronger feedback loops? And how do we provide frameworks for artists and designers to respond or not? And lastly, why would we wait for an unrest to make these issues relevant? So Baltimore is still in a state of unrest, I would claim. In many ways, our uprising continues. At MICA, we believe this is a historic time for the city to come together and for artists and designers to use their unique talents to contribute in creative, productive ways with the community to address systemic problems. Because Baltimore is a city of a particular size, we really sense that we have an ability to work in new ways to refocus our education to help build an economy of empathy, to come together and to tackle the city's challenges. So in order to do that, as Sheila Gaskins, who's a local Baltimore artist, says, we should not be calling each other out. We need to call each other in. This is our time to be working with the community, and I believe that MICA and our artists and designers have an important role to play in that process in Baltimore. So thank you.
Thank you.
So I want to ask a question or make a comment, and Obehi, ask you and Gwen to maybe comment on this. The word I keep hearing over the last couple days, because I was here for a pre-conference as well, and from both of you, is this word of art and empathy, and the notion of art and empathy. Could you talk about that a little bit? And I love that term, economy of empathy, right? Could the two of you sort of talk about that a little bit?
I think I'm definitely going to quote your friend on that. That's what I've been talking about, Kayla Ingram, about a lot. Before I started acting, I really came from a storytelling background. I actually think that helped me become a better actor, was to put myself in situations where I was vulnerable and sharing, and I could hear other people share. And I think what was interesting about Creative Witness was there was actually a really powerful mixed crowd. What also was interesting about that time was there was a nice, I'm saying nice meaning, there was a really honest discussion about elevating voices from people of color. So that when there was a rally, when there was time, like when there was a bullhorn, essentially the discomfort of having to tell well-meaning white people, this is not your space right now, this is not your safe space, this is our safe space. So from a lot of people of color, there was like you would just see Facebook groups like hashing it out online. So that was happening. But I think that what I was able to do with my friend and with people in that space at that time was, honestly, like there were people of faith, like there were Christians who were like praying, there were people who were singing. There was just a sign of like, we're not perfect, but if we can just be present with one another, then that's enough to just do that. So that's what I felt was like the empathy kind of building. I did want to say that, you know, it does bother me, but I will be honest, I'm fearful. Okay, I don't want to be too fearful.
Okay.
But the idea of when we need art and how our response was to something that was happening nationally, I just really don't want Boston to erupt in that way, but sometimes I fear it's coming. And then I wonder, like, will artists feel, like, what will happen, right? Like, will the art come? So just because even when I was curating and just putting something up, it felt a little dangerous, and I wondered why. And I think it's because, really, like, Boston, right now, we have a sort of culture of, like, damage control. So why did I operate from that space, right? So if we're talking about looking forward, I would say I look forward to creating spaces out of no fear. And I think that's where, when we talk about institutional support or sort of just like the individual artist versus somebody else, I think that's that fear thing is what I'm really dwelling on these days.
Because you feel like you don't have support?
Or more so the self-doubt. I mean, even doing that, because it wasn't about me, I didn't know what I was doing. Like, I remember people would ask me, who did this? And I was just like, I lied. Like, people would ask, like, who's the leader of this event? And I didn't want to take responsibility because I didn't want my face to be, like, the face of a movement because I'm going to say personally for me, I do feel like the Black Lives Matter movement is not about one person, personally, but I know there's contention over that nationally and through Twitter mostly, but do you know what I'm saying? So even locally for me as an artist, I really just wanted the space to be what the space was. I just wanted it to be activated. I didn't want the credit. Mm-hmm. So I'm still thinking about that.
Right. A number of the activists, and by the way, in St. Louis, and I don't think this is just a St. Louis thing, but artists and activists have started to call themselves artivists, which is a little cute, but it works. Mm-hmm. And so when I refer to the artivists, one of the things that they tell me is that they feel like it's a leaderless movement and it's leaderless on purpose. Now, I don't know if that's possible from my point of view, that there's really no leadership, because I think there is. But that's how they're perceiving it. And it sounds to me, Obehi, that is one of the things that you're trying to project, mm-hmm. is that it's not about me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say that. I've also never called myself an artivist. I love that though. I really do, because I do have friends that are artivists, self-proclaimed, and that works for them.
Yeah.
For me, it was really just the needing the space to happen, and I look forward to doing more of that. But at the same time, I'm aware that there's just this interesting thing about, like, I really don't want Boston to compare itself to other cities. But I'm interested into why our public art making is not a practice. Like, it's just not practiced. So that's what I mean by sort of like hacking a space mm-hmm. in the future. I feel like I've had good conversations with friends and colleagues about what it would mean to just show up. And why is that so dangerous?
And this notion of sanctioned and unsanctioned.
Essentially, I'm right? essentially calling most sanctioning.
Right. Right. Gwen, do you have anything you want to comment about that?
Did we start with empathy?
We started with empathy.
I had something to say about empathy.
It's fine. I travel with my words. I was not going to apologize for that.
Do you want me to talk about empathy?
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. Sure.
So the economy of empathy was coined by Kayla Ingram, and I have come to really appreciate it because when we talk about economy, I think we're talking about an exchange. And when we're talking, I think, about the kinds of models of change, it seems to be kind of fundamental to working, as you said so I think eloquently, with community, that is this kind of groundwork for doing that work. Kayla, I don't think I've heard her say she's an artivist, but she is very much an activist within the city and, you know, was arrested for sitting in at City Hall and doesn't really distinguish her practice, I think, from what she does. And what she said to me was, you know, Gwen, I don't really believe that design is a kind of, she's a social design major or kind of graduate. She doesn't really believe that kind of design is the solution. She really believes that communities are the solution and that her work would be kind of building communities to find their own solutions. And so that economy of empathy, I think, is kind of how she might actually help and work with communities to build and advance themselves. So her goal, and she has a year, kind of she has a fellowship year following her graduation, where she'll be working in Baltimore, is to work with historically black institutions to kind of advance. She really just wants to help build them within the institute and within the city. And she's got like 10 different projects at this point. I mean, she literally just graduated. But I think that's kind of how she sees her work is to get under and help, kind of support and build communities from the inside out. And I think that economy of empathy is really what needs to be there in order to do that.
Notion of being with. Mm-hmm. You know, I would love to open this up to the audience and if there's questions or comments from anyone. Yes.
I think it is.
Right.
Hi, thank you all so much for this wonderful discussion. Again, my name is Nicole DeWald. I'm a resident of Baltimore City and a performing artist there. I'm also an arts administrator in the city of Greenbelt, Maryland. And if you don't mind, I just wanted to follow on with your wonderful explanation of Micah's response to the events in Baltimore with an additional supplemental field report.
Please,
because I'd love us to start from that wonderful and thorough, and thank you for all that detail in that, and kind of remember to maintain a broad perception of who is an artist and what artistic responses to this crisis we want to recognize. And also, something to keep in mind about the range of responses that a community can have to a crisis like this, because it might be surprising to some people. One of the things that came out of it was some spontaneous viral documentary video that I think was outstanding. And if you haven't seen it already, there's a wonderful clip of a young man confronting Geraldo Rivera that is not to be missed.
Yeah.
You know, we've all talked about the importance of technology in documenting, you know, bearing witness in really critical ways to actual events that happen, but it's just as important in documenting the response, which can be truly amazing. I'd like to give a shout out to Black Cherry Puppet Theater, just another tip for arts organizations. Should difficult events of any kind befall your community, to be aware of the practical needs of your citizens, because one of the things that happened in Baltimore after these events was the schools were shut down, and the children needed somewhere safe to go. So Black Cherry, and I'm sure other Jubilee, and other arts organizations immediately opened their doors, scrambled their staff and volunteers, and provided wonderful, loving programming for the kids who needed them immediately. Also, there was an incredible scene in Baltimore. Ironically, the night after the uprising, there was a curfew. And those of you who know Baltimore, as I say, won't be surprised by this, maybe, but others might be. With the spontaneous artistic responses that we had then. Because the biggest challenge that the National Guard had on that second night were the dance party that wouldn't stop. This is Baltimore. There was drumming and dancing. This is very, very organic, grassroots artistic response. There was a lot of very, very serious art that came out of it, including the Freddie Gray mural and the whole series that came from that. All the serious discussion. Very important, very serious street actions, but that's not all of it. There was also people going immediately to their place of strength and joy and resilience. And that, to me, is part of the meaning of the uprising, that intergenerational crews of drummers and dancers were out there that night. There was roller disco. We have a local guy who's a Michael Jackson impersonator, who's kind of a local figure who is up on top of a box truck doing his thing. And within a couple of weeks, there were 1,000 cyclists from the Baltimore Bike Party in that neighborhood expressing their solidarity. So the artistic response was really incredibly broad-ranging. I just want to acknowledge those participants.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think there was a question somewhere else. Yes.
Hi. Obey, you mentioned that you didn't want to see in Boston what has happened in several other American cities over the past couple of years. I'm representing New Orleans, where I live and work, and I feel similarly, and I recognize that one of the potential tipping points in our city right now is, fascinatingly, around monuments, very literally, in that we have a series of monuments that were erected in the late 1800s, early 1900s, that are representing flatly racist white figures. And Robert E. Lee is the most visible example. And so what has been sort of unfolding over the past year or so, and will continue to unfold, is that there are many groups that have actually gotten the mayor of New Orleans' support to tear down these monuments. And what happens to them after, who knows? But there's building civic support to bring these monuments down for what they represent in an already very unequal and polarized city. There's also a very strong coalition on the opposite side. And predictably, the lines are drawn by race, not totally, but that element is there. So I guess what thinking about it, I'm the president and CEO of the Arts Council of New Orleans, and thinking about this issue from an institutional perspective, the Arts Council is the city arts agency in New Orleans, and the Arts Council should and will be involved in this process from before, during, and after, and I hope will help guide a positive envisioning of what can happen next, if and when I think these monuments go down. Again, from an institutional perspective, I guess I'm curious, especially for the people on the panel who are representing institutions, how did you navigate the politics of position taking in such a polarized atmosphere? Thank you.
Yeah.
They're looking at me. So I want to posit that there might be a third space when we're talking about monuments. That coming from a public art background, I know how much it costs to take down one of those monuments. That is a lot of money. So the third space might be to commission a contemporary artist to make a response next to or in some way juxtaposed to that monument. The other space might be that you could rename, relabel that monument. We're talking a lot about it in St. Louis because there's a monument in Forest Park, which is our main park, that was erected by the Daughters of the Confederacy, right, to uplift the Confederate soldiers that died in the war. So we're talking about what do you do about that, right? Does it belong in a history museum? Do you destroy it? Do you do something in which you speak to it? My fantasy is that we could commission an artist like Fred Wilson to create a monument next to it that would speak to what that's all about and what our history is. In St. Louis, for instance, our history is literally a division during the Civil War. Literally, the city was divided between North and South. That Civil War battles happened in downtown St. Louis. So, you know, how do we talk about that? All of that goes into who we are as a city and goes into what happened with Mike Brown. Those things don't happen in vacuums. Our history is long. And I understand wanting to dismantle symbols of oppression. And in some cases, I think that's exactly what we should do. In other cases, I'm wondering if we should, and I'm asking this question, I don't have the answer to it, create spaces in which we can have dialogue and talk about what our history means. I always am afraid when we erase history. Mm-hmm. That makes me very nervous. This is a really interesting time because I think that's happening everywhere, not just in New Orleans. And I don't have a solution to it. But when we're talking about history and we're talking about what that means to groups of people, I always think there might be a third space rather than either or, and that maybe we should be talking about that third space. And I may be wrong, and I'm glad to be wrong, but it's something I've been thinking about a lot lately.
We have four monuments that have been under a kind of part of a special review. The mayor put together a kind of council of folks to advise on what to do with these four Civil War monuments. And I don't think they've actually had an official decision, but I did speak with an artist who had served, Alyssa Moorhead, who had served on this commission. And she was really advocating not to take them down, but to use them as an educational opportunity. That the institutions that they were most associated with, and sometimes that's the Baltimore Museum of Art, or that is Johns Hopkins University, or we have one also kind of from the Daughters of the Confederacy, very close to Micah. It's actually on public land, but it's on our street. To kind of reach to those institutions to create some kind of educational opportunity with them so as not to erase the history, I think, as you said. But it is not been determined, I don't think, officially. And I tended to think about what that third space, as Roseanne had described it, was as well.
I think that, I'm a creator, right? So, the thing that frustrates me the most about institutional support, lack of, or even the possibility of it, is knowing that somebody might say no to you. So I think the most powerful thing is space essentially is saying, I'm going to help you create something out of nothing. So that's what I would hope from institutions to continue to do as somebody who is often looking up and sort of idolizing and not knowing that behind an institution are people who are really trying to figure things out.
That's good.
True.
Any other comments or questions?
There's one over there.
Yes.
So I'm Erin Johnson. I run a small community organization in Cambridge.
Small but mighty.
Small but mighty, thank you. We've been in this neighborhood for close to 80 years, and it's being very quickly gentrified. So there's a lot of concern, despair, desire for action on the part of our young people, our families. So I think part of the reason I came here, Obehi kind of put that question into the ether, so I was thinking about that, is the idea of how do we as a small but mighty institution allow and support our young people and families in putting ideas into the world through artwork that are divisive, that do challenge larger institutions, city government, without putting our organization at risk. Because we are a small organization founded by families in a housing development that, you know, is at risk for not existing potentially in years to come. So I think that was the nut of the question that I wanted to hear about. Mm-hmm. Because I do think it feels very risky to us. We have corporations that fund us, so how do we speak against corporations? We have government that funds us, so how do we question how they deal with low-income housing in our city, or how do we make sure that happens? And I think we're willing to take those risks, but I'm curious what experiences other people have had in taking risks like that and still preserving, you know, your organization and your funding sources and important dialogue that needs to happen between those sectors.
You know, I want to speak to that for a moment because, as Obehi just said, I may represent an institution, right, an arts agency, but that agency is full of people who are very interested in the same things that you're interested in, right? And we have a freedom of expression policy, and one of the things is that we actually sometimes wonder why more people aren't pounding on our door. Volunteer Lawyers and Accountants for the Arts is housed in our building, and Sue Greenberg is one of our faculty for the Community Arts Training Institute, and every time there would be a commotion outside, she'd come in my office and say, "Roseanne, finally, the artists must be coming for their money." So, you know, and they never did. We had to say, we had to do a survey, we had to figure out what artists needed because no one was demanding it. So, you know, I hope that you don't live in a space of fear that your funding will be cut off because of what you're doing is controversial. And we're unique because we're regional and we're not housed in a mayor's office, for instance, so we can be a little less political. But I think there are lots of places that like that. I think there are lots of places where being risky and risk-taking should be okay. Should be okay. I always think I'm getting away with something when I'm talking about the Community Arts Training Institute it's about social change. Art is an agent for social change. And I guess I'm not talking about making the world more conservative. I'm talking about making the world more empathetic and open. So, you know, that's, for some people, I suppose that would be controversial. But I guess what I'm saying is I hope that this is not something that is guiding you, this fear of risk or this fear of being controversial with your funders. Does that make sense? Anybody else have a comment?
I mean, I just have a response to you, Erin, only because I've seen your work. I mean, like my friend, your colleague friend, Jaranzi, I mean, I remember specifically telling her, you work with youth, you create experimental theater that I've never seen in the city. And it hit me that she's creating this very, like, subversive art with people who are under 13. So what I've done is I've just, like, I've sat in rehearsal, volunteered my time, but then in my mind I'm thinking, I'm like, You know, it actually doesn't matter who you would invite. Like, you should, I would say, and I'm sure you know this, but like, you should be able to invite anybody to see some really good art. And I remember specifically last year's play, which was done at the Cambridge YMCA, it specifically attacked, you know, what's going on with gentrification, and like, what do we say when like violence happens in an area like it happens in Central Square? But all I could think was just like, but it's just good art. So why couldn't I invite said council person or like person who has tons of money, right? Like, and again, like there's a whole discussion about like, even as an individual artist, like, how do you seek out networks and like just having people to people conversations and not worrying about like pocketbooks, but like seriously just like, hey, this is a great experimental play. There are young people who are devising work from scratch. That's why you should see it. And then you're gonna be surprised by the message. But you don't have to tell people. Do you see what I'm saying? So that's where I'm interested in terms of like community-driven art that happens in an actual space or happens in the public, like just elevating it. I feel like when I saw your images, I'm gonna apologize, but not really. But I don't have images from Creative Witness because, you know, very much it was happening like in secret. Like all of the images are in Instagrams and Facebook, so I didn't want to. And they were really grainy, bad pictures. But I'm saying that like. But even the caliber of art that you all presented and the caliber of art that Community Art Center has, that's my in as somebody who is a stakeholder, somebody who knows that there is some really transcendent stuff going on at that place. So if like the head of GE or the head of AT&T needs to be invited, it's because it's good art. They should be there. There's too much stuff happening rapidly right now with like people with money entering Boston and Cambridge and Somerville that I feel like we as artists should just be more bold. It's hard, I think it's hard, but I also think that like that's the stuff. And I'm learning that, I'm literally speaking to myself.
All right, we'll take one more question and then it'll be cocktail hour.
I have questions, I don't know, there are questions for me though, but Terry Olson from Orlando. One comment, I was thinking about the tearing down memorials kind of thing, and we've got a monument to the Confederate soldier in town, and there's been some discussion about that. What just struck me, and I wasn't comfortable with it, but was how appalled I was when the Taliban tore down sculptures that they didn't like that were oppressive to them. So that made me think about some things. The questions we're having now, 5 days after the mass shootings, were a very different situation in that an outside person came in to our community. We're not dealing with internal problems in this. So we're like, our arts community is coming together to do a number of things, but creating an event a couple weeks from now, but it's for us. Like there have been people from the international and national stage that would have come and, you know, be part of that, and some of them might be there. But we're not advertising that because it's for us. And we're creating a journey from mourning to hope. You know, so this is what we're doing. But at the same time, we're starting to think about what kind of permanent memorials should we have. And questions I'm having right now, sorry, I'm kind of rambling, but who are these for? Like this event, I said, is for us. It's for our community, our arts community. It's not for other people. And who can we influence? Because obviously the state of Florida, with its outside of Orlando, has a governor and an attorney general that aren't in the same realm as our mayor and where we're at, I think, as a community. So it's not locally that we need to make influence to make change. So these are just the questions that I have in my mind. I thought I would share them with you.
You know, it sounds like there's different reasons to create monuments. And in the moment, it may be the reason that you're creating these monuments, temporary or permanent, is that you're in mourning, that it isn't about an issue, that it's about mourning. And I think in my opinion, you all should allow yourselves to mourn. And if that's what the art is doing, then make the most beautiful art that will allow you to mourn. And not worry about the message. The message will be there. Anybody? I'm gonna close on that note. I really wanna thank all of you very much this time of the afternoon to come and participate with us and have questions and listen. Thank you so much.